thank you for being admitted to this conference, to this workshop, because as you will quickly see, my contribution is not really like yours. It's a little bit, say, more general. And I think I hope I can convince you that it still makes sense and it might shed some light on the background, on the whole frame, that is how we speak of intended or expected or unintended consequences and stuff like this. So I will give a quick outlook of the Ouroboros model. That's what this cognitive architecture is called. I will talk a little bit about discrepancies, inequalities. And I will also say something about how we get new schemata and how this gives a little bit hope in ethics and in a negative imperative on fairness and on avoiding to be harm, which maybe gives some current connection then to also corona crisis. And as we all know, no fixed rules, and we see that nowadays very carefully and very good, no fixed rule adapts. We have to have adapting schemata and criteria to really meet the requirements. So let me start by saying what the Ouroboros model is. Basically, the main thing is that it's a dynamic structure, it's a process model, it's not something static, and you can see it as an extension of the perceptual cycle from NASA in 1976, where he had perception and exploration before and schemata before, or the other way around. It's all in a circle. And what I say here is, whatever you do, you have an anticipation and expectation what will be next, whatever you do. And you have, this is the core of the model, some evaluation, dynamic monitoring stage, which tells you what to do next. So this actually is not restricted to single brains. Also, it started out as a theory of brain modeling. It's also applying to artificial intelligence and just the same as to societies and states, if you want. So the main thing is, all that we know is stored in fixed, not really fixed, hierarchy of schemata. And we do in a major step a monitoring between what comes in at a certain stage and what we expect from the pre-existing schema or schemata. And applying or referring to what we heard of yesterday of the gut feeling, one upshot of the Ouroboros model is that some vague and general feedback from this monitoring loop is a measure of goodness of fit. And this is what I came to be the feeling components of emotion. So you don't need to go into the details. The point is, it's a circular setup, but it's not really circular. You gotta imagine it as a spiral, because you learn something from one loop to the next. And it's an active process, it unfolds over time. You can easily expand that, and you can see if something doesn't fit, you try to have a new schema, and if it doesn't fit either, you make a new memory, you make a reset, but all of this can be read, and it's not possible to explain this here in a 10 or 20 minute presentation. The real relevant thing is that we can discern three regimes. When you think of this loop, if everything fits more or less, then there's nothing special to do about it. But there's two special highlighted occasions. Something can fit extraordinarily well, better than expected, or it cannot fit at all. And this is occasions where you better store a new memory. That is, you want to have a repetition of the situation where everything fitted or extraordinarily, or if it didn't fit at all with your expectations, you want to make sure that next time you avoid the situation to come into this. And by repetition, you can also have something like grinding in of a schemata. What fits more or less often will then be also laid down and say grinded in. And abstraction is just a special case of this grinding in of repetitions. Actually, you can say repetitions are also positive because if it repeats, it's at least stable and you can rely on it. And all of this is, say, autocatalytically. You don't need a supervisor. The model steers itself and finds out by its own criteria if something is worthwhile to be remembered or not. And this then is the basis for the next iterations and for the next steps to do. Important point, this is similar at all levels of abstraction. It goes from simple reflexes up to the most intricate considerations. The basic process is the same, irrespective of what the content of the involved schemata is. So in terms of cognitive science, you can say this is attentive, because there we really think of it, we get our attention directed to it, and we store it. This would be pre-attentive, and repeating myself autocatalytically means that it's not under the control of the initial designer. The initial designer maybe made up the loop, but then it's out of hand, and the system decides itself how it will, where it will develop. So consumption analysis highlights slots in this monitoring loop. You have attention steered to the points where there's a deviation between your expectations stemming from the old schema and the incoming current data. And this schema that you kind of excite vaguely as a start gives you also a measure of importance or relevance. And all of this, of course, is only inside the accessible frame. If you don't know of something, it cannot really catch your attention, to say it very simply. So problem solving then would be some type of pattern matching combined with constraint satisfaction. And if you do it properly, you can see that production systems are a special case of this whole schema and process. And if you assign proper weights, this is can be seen as a special version of Bayesian operation. So very simple observation, when you fill in something like new observations into an old structure, like old schemata, the obvious thing to do is check how well it fits. And this feedback then allows you to set the optimum stage for the next actions. And this general measure, say in this picture, how much you spill, or if you spill at all, is some measure as a goodness of fit. It tells you how well you're doing, and in our life, we would call it the feeling component of an emotion, other components then being really depending on the content, what we worry about or what we are angry about. But the general basis feeling would be this goodness of fit. So knowledge is stored in schemata, and they make up the basis and the foundation of it, what we can even think, and adequacy, that is how well they cover the potential inputs, coherence, how they are covering with holes or not, and consistency are the crucial things to determine the sheer performance of cognition. And actually it also applies to action, because think of a athlete, if he has no coherent body schema, he cannot perform nothing. So more to the point of the workshop, Schemata fix their scopes of application, and they also tell you what normal is. So a schema tells you what to expect in a certain in a certain situation. The schemata are to some extent inherited, to some extent, of course, they reflect what you have encountered before. So it really depends on your history, whether you're an expert in one field or the other. And with this schemata, you try then to explain and understand the world around you. And of course, this can result in strong biases or blind spots. This is more or less just inevitable. So if you think that the Uroboros model gives a good model of how cognition could work, then you come to the conclusion that this compartmentalization is kind of inevitable. You cannot do without some covering of the whole area of experiences with disjoint schemata, and of course, as they have to be disjoint, otherwise you cannot see if something fits or doesn't fit. Then, of course, you can also run into problems that if you excite a schemata from rather different fields, a little bit apart, they might come into mutual contradiction, and because they were just meant to be used in the same time for one and the same context. So splitting to in and out groups would be just one particular example of an ancient schema. Maybe already animals have this, and it's still active in modern humans and contexts. You cannot avoid that, and you see those in the corona crisis. I repeat this because I think it's really essential. It seems to me that you cannot really overcome such a division into kind of distinct schemata, and as you can't avoid it, you try to use it or to shape it so it doesn't make too much harm. So as we have not infinite mental power and we have no time, there is always limits how much you can fit, and this applies also to symmetries in the equilibria. Equilibria meaning that you have nice fit between your expectations and what actually happens around you. But there is hope that you could have in this hierarchy of schema very high concepts which important to most of the people, and one hope or observation hopefully would be that if you have such high level schemata being shared, like preventing loss of life, you might have a common ground for action for many human beings. But looking at corona, you still might see the limitations to this. Nowadays, it looks like every state tries to do its best or what they think it's best for its own state and not thinking really of Europe or the world. But as you hopefully see from this, it's not static. The picture is evolving, and you have to have adaptations to both the schemata, which goes more or less automatically, but maybe also to your criteria to determine what in the end is satisfactory. And what's the time? Okay. The autonomy, I stressed, is very much important. And actually in this model, you get it for free. It's an inherent schema, but then you see how come that people work together. And well, they talk to each other and they come to common abstractions like justice. This is a concept that I think is shared more or less universally in the world, also in the big cultural blocks of, say, West and East or whoever. And this might be a way to come together. So fairness was proposed as a grounding for justice. And in the concept of fairness from roles, the wheel of ignorance plays a most important role. He says you have to consider to be the most disadvantaged in a group to do the right thing to help disadvantaged members. And if you don't know what you are, then you better do the best for the least advantaged. So in the Europorus model, this is very much consistent with what Kant said. And in the Europorus model, you can see that absolute justice just doesn't exist. If it's an abstraction, and it's an abstraction of schemata that it grows up, then you maybe come to the conclusion that the basic components are personal dignity, actions compatible with survival and progress, but it's not something that you can cut in stone and say, that's it. What I claim is so that, as Hume already observed, you cannot derive any ought from these. So there is no way of declaring something must be done because it's such and such. But what you could find out is some oughts, not some things that are really prohibited. And this is what I claim to give rise to a negative imperative, especially and even more so in modern times, with tight common restrictions and interlaced complex links and dependencies between partners. Any violent action with high probability has negative impacts also on the actor and the whole world, and thus should be avoided for his or her own most intrinsic self-interest or, say, collective interest. So if you have a limited world, if you do a violent action, it will come back to you and will hurt yourself. So the hope is, considering this, people refrain from violent actions because they will hurt themselves. And self-interest, say, enlightened self-interest, is really a major component here. And basically, it achieves the same results as the wheel of roles, but it does this much more natural and understandable. And just an aside, this applies to states, aliens, or artificial intelligence. And still, you have this autonomy, you have to constrain it, otherwise you cannot make this self-consistently fit. Maybe a little bit closer again to the workshop. Nothing is more natural than to expect that something does not fit. I think this is a real red line in human existence. It's just the most obvious, there are things which cannot fit. There is what I explained, the legs, the open slots in schemata, where you have an idea of what is happening, and then you see the real input doesn't fit with your expectations based on experience. And so you dig out more information, you search for more, and try to fill the slots. This was the known unknowns, but there's also the unknown unknowns. You have to be more or less sure that your patchwork of schemata over all field of possible experience is not complete. What you have not learned, what you have not encountered, what you have no concept for to think, gives a discrepancy, and you have to be, or must almost be sure that this happens, and it's unknown. You don't know where the fringes, the rims of your knowledge really are, and so you might be surprised when you encounter them, but you shouldn't, because it's obvious your hierarchy of schemata cannot cover the whole world, as it's just patchwork and done in limited boundary conditions like time and cognitive capacity. You can have the perfect fitting only in very confined and well-constricted circumstances, like, say, logics in finite dimension fields as soon as you start to allow some infinite leaks, the unintended can sneak into. Gödel would be just an example. Of course, I cannot have this talk without speaking about Corona, as I had prepared this a little bit early. This is just the last slide. Saying something to Corona. So we had this before. We hope, or we think to observe, that another common threat to die, even if it's with a small probability, many people are willing to accept very severe limitations in their civil rights. We observed this basically all over the world, at least for a couple of months, and only now, after say 2 months, people start to complain about the limitations, and that is expected. So, of course, they know that their personal behavior, or most of them know that their personal behavior has an impact on their personal health and survival. And I want to exemplify this. It's also known to others and used by, say, propaganda. I take it now as an example, an encouraging example, that the negative imperative really works, and just look at this now everywhere visible sign in Switzerland. It is how to protect yourself and others. So you have the distancing, you stay home, you wash your hands, you don't make handshakes, you call the right way, and you don't jump to the doctor's office, but rather call him first. And what I want to point out is that the first sentence, and it's the same basically in Austria, and it's the two that I've checked, is a first appeal to something like enlightened egoism to make people aware that it's in their own and in the common interest to do these actions. So for a concrete situation, and this is, you see here, where you really know what you are trying to prevent or try to avoid, you can have positive commandments. Where, as I said before, that on a very general level, as discussed by Hume, you can't have positive commandments, but you can still have a negative imperative saying that if you care of something, you rather avoid certain things which might ruin the whole thing. So thank you for your attention. And of course, if you have ideas for collaboration, I would be most appreciating that, and they would be most welcome. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Knut. Now it's time for questions and comments, please. Yes, of course. Go ahead.
So I think it's our second encounter with this model, but it changed from the I mean, because I know you are working on it, I also saw some publication, but it changed because you introduced the ignorance elements. So I think it's much more the under impact of social sciences. So my question is that I like very much your model. I think I was wondering, because it's a self-referential model, which is based to a great extent on data accumulation and information scrutiny and experience. But today, if we are looking at public policy, we see that the public policy is based much more, it's about the future. For example, Taleb, he is the author who introduced this term of the black swan, and Black swans in the sense of huge events which people, after they take place, think that they were predicted, like the refugee crisis or COVID. But anyway, the idea is that this author, he's saying that in public policy, there should be a change, in the sense that this model, when we are all the time looking at what we did wrong and we try to evaluate and to bring some error correction, that this model is not functioning, that actually we have other cognitive strategies. And what we notice, we and my colleagues, is that, for example, in public policy, there is people are looking at the future and they adapt to the changing circumstances. So they not so much evaluate, and it's not any such more a feedback mechanism, but it's they are much more projecting, looking at the future, and they adapt to the changing. They adapt their behavior and also their narrative. But then your model is fits into this context, because the way we imagine the future, it's very much it's dependent on our past experience. So the national context, it's very much embedded in this oral geopolitics. So I was wondering if you can comment maybe on this future dimension of your model. I know that you have these expectations, but when I'm thinking about expectation, it's something which is happening in the present based on the past experience. But it has a future component, but it does not have this component of preparation. It's like expectation doesn't involve action.
I partly agree. So first thing, thank you for your nice words. And of course, I would just game the model has not changed, but proclaiming an adaptive and learning architecture, I tried to learn myself. And in the first encounter last year, I got a little bit better feeling of you, what you might be interested in and what might make the connection to this world, which is really kind of alien to me because, you know, I'm a physicist. So if you see a difference, then I learned and I tried to present something which to your expectations. This is one thing. The other thing, of course, expectations as you describe and people now thinking of more the future, that's actually an outcome of the monitoring. They see to some extent that the normal models do not work. You cannot continue like you did half a year ago, because otherwise you just accept many people dying unnecessarily. So you see in this monitoring, as described in the Roboros model, that the schemata that you have do not really fit. So you have to take something new, and what people do now observe that they go back to structures which to some extent others have thought that might be outdated, like the states or even counties get much more importance than they had a year ago. It's states that close their borders, and it's counties which maybe have special rules, and it's not so much the schema that we had a year ago of a free Schengen country, European Union, one thing. This is one thing. And the other thing, and I think this is encouraging, is that as people experience and see that the expectations, the normal schema that do not fit, they try to ask the experts. There is virologists who know a little bit more than others, and they are now in high esteem, and they have a word in TV and in deciding politics, or at least counseling politics, which were not so 2 years ago. You know, in Austria, observed that any good politicians, to be acceptable by the general public, he had to declare that he was bad in mathematics in school. If he said he was good, people would say, oh, stuck up guy, cannot really know our problems, we can't elect him. So I think one good thing out of Corona could be that there is some renewed estimation and appreciation of expert knowledge, because these experts have more refined, more elaborate schemata, and their, say, prognosis and their anticipations of what would come if you do this action or if you don't do these actions, now, bluntly speaking, of lives to be missed, they are more important than before, because in normal lives you don't need that much expertise than as in very extraordinary situations as we have now.
Yes, but okay, but this is very much orientated towards the future. So in COVID, for example, and this was discussed yesterday at the panel, that there might be this option that to discuss how we turned in this situation. But if you focus on the future and what you have to do now, then you also ignore what brought you here. So it's a completely different kind of argumentation. And in a way, but by focusing, I think that including this component of the future, it will show that people don't all the time evaluate. I think they also adapt. So they transform themselves. You know what I mean? So it's like
You see, Pierre Bohr's model is actually in hyperactive loop. So if you have a loop structure, it's really hard to tell this is the beginning and this is the end. You could just say this is the end and this is the beginning. It just goes on. And what I claim is that it is no vicious cycle going in a plane, but it's more like a spiraling up, because when you have fulfilled the loop, you have learned something, and next time you can adapt better. And as to the corona crisis, you know, if we are lucky, we have in 5 years from now enough data to really understand and be able to evaluate what actions at what time were helpful, what were disturbing, and what were even detrimental, because no one in the world now has the overview to really tell that this is good or this is bad, because nobody can see all consequences. And this is also an upshot of the robots model. Be always modest and understand that whatever you understand, it's only a very limited view and fraction of perspectives on the world which you happen to learn, which you happen to experience so far. And there might be others which are completely alien to you.